A very good morning to one and all. We all have gathered here for the webinar on Introduction to Automotive Antenna Design, organized by IEEE Student Branch and Electronics and Communication Department of Ahilya School of Engineering and Technology. First and foremost, I would like to welcome our Vice Principal and IEEE Student Branch Counselor, Dr. Krishnakumar Kishore, sir. We are very grateful for your presence, sir. Next, I would like to welcome HOD of Electronics and Communication Engineering Department, Dr. V. Balamurugan, sir. We are so grateful, sir. Next, I would like to invite our resource person of the day, Mr. Abhilash Balachandran. We are so happy and looking forward to the great session, sir. Next, I would like to welcome all the faculties and also all my fellow friends for this event. Now, speaking about our resource person, Mr. Abhilash Balachandran is an alumni of Ahilya School of Engineering and Technology from Electronics and Communication Department, passed out in 2017. He has worked in Data Patterns Private Limited as an antenna, RF antenna design engineer from 2017-18. He is currently in Valeo India Private Limited as an hardware design engineer from 2018 to the till date. He is a certified trainer for MathCAD tool used in electronics design, and he is certified on on-job trainer for power stability analysis of DC-DC converters using Bolt 100 tool. He is currently working on expertise in antenna design and development and pursuing M.Tech in automotive electronics from BITS Pilani. Without further ado, I would like to invite Abhilash sir to start the session. So it's all yours.
Thank you so much. That was a great intro. Yeah. So first of all, thank you, HOD sir, Dr. Balamurugan sir, and also Santosh sir. And I have to thank separately KK sir. So Krishnakumar sir, as he told that I am alumni of Ahilya Engineering College. So in my college days and in my project, KK sir helped me a lot. And I am standing in front of you as an antenna design engineer. So all the credits goes to Krishnakumar sir. So thank you all, and I will present my screen. Okay, so my screen and voice is clear. Can I get a yes from a student? Okay, somebody chat, I think. Okay, I will start.
It's clear, Abhilash.
Yeah, okay, fine. Yes. So, introduction to automotive antenna. So, if some students may don't understand what is automotive. So, automotive means something related to vehicle transportation, anything. So, the car manufacturing IC designed, all these things, anything related to car or any vehicle, truck, anything is called as automotive. So I am currently working in an automotive industry in the company Valeo. So here we use different kind of antennas. So that's why I want to discuss something about automotive antennas to introduce to students. So it will be help you while you getting into a industry. So quick introduction about me. So I am also I was also an Ahilya student, passed out in 2017. And from off-campus interview, I joined Data Patterns Private Limited. And from there, I learned antenna design, RF design, everything I learned. And I worked there with defense and aerospace team, like ISRO, DRDO. So I was working as an antenna design engineer for a radar application there. And after 1 year, I jumped to Valeo, which is my current company. So as of now, I am working as an hardware design engineer there. And as he already mentioned, Sanjay already mentioned, so I'm a certified trainer for MathCAD tool. So you students are already aware of MathLab. Maybe you may get some workshop on that. So similarly, in industry, we use MathCAD. MathCAD is similar to MathLab, but it is more user-friendly. So I'm certified trainer for that. I will give you a quick intro if time allows about this MathCAD. I will postpone to last. So next, you may aware of power stability analysis for DC to DC converters using body plot. I'm certified on-job trainer for that. And also I'm currently working on my expertise path. Like some students may don't understand what is expertise. So expertise means like doctors will do some expertising in some cardiology and some other domain. No? Similarly, in an industry, we can also explore ourselves in different domain. So I choose antenna design. Since I got a lot of basics of antenna design from Mahalia Engineering College through KKSR. So I choose that domain and I'm working on that expertise path. And after all, I'm an MTech student pursuing automotive electronics from BITS Pilani. So always you can, I'm just like you, a student. So you can always talk me and you can interrupt me if you have any query and you can ask query at any time. Okay. So yeah. Anything to add upon this, Sandor sir or KK sir? Or can I go ahead?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. So scope of the presentation. So as I already mentioned that I am expertising in antenna domain. So I, as per our company rule, I have to give some knowledge transfer to students, upcoming students. You are the upcoming engineers. So I have to give some knowledge transfer from industry to college. So this is the main motto of this presentation. So in this presentation, what I will do is I will give you a brief introduction about antennas, which is used in automotive application. And before that, we have to know that how antenna is actually working and which all parameters of antenna, which we will use in industrial domain. So next, I will give a quick introduction about phased array antenna. So I hope here third year students will be there, second year students will be there, and different department students also might be there. So for third year students, it will be more easy to grasp what I am telling. And for second year students, you have to put some extra effort to understand this. If you face any difficulty also, it is okay. You just understand the basic of antenna, how it is working and which of parameters. It will be helping you in next year. And I will also telling you how in industry we know how to design antenna, how to manufacture antenna. So after getting that manufactured antenna, we have to test whether it is complying with all our specification or parameters. So how we will test or validate that in our lab. So that also I will quickly introduce. And if time is there, I will show you some simulations and will give you some simulation tools which we use to simulate antennas. Okay. Yeah, that's all. And before starting it, yeah, just quick question. What is the difference between a signal and a wave? Okay. So what is signal? So signal means anything, any varying current. Which is flowing through either wires, or it can be through coaxial cables, or it can be through RF traces. So if people don't know RF traces, this is the traces which we call in PCB. So this is the overall PCB, and here you can see one trace will be there. This is a conductive like a metal, copper or anything, which will carry current signals. Okay, so these all things are the path for electrical signals. So in electrical signals, what it will do, it will only deals with voltage and current. Okay. And next, what is wave? So wave is actually a electromagnetic radiation, which might be coming from across around the current carrying conductor. It can come surrounding to that, or it can be coming from antenna, or if you didn't design a PCB properly, that PCB itself will act as an antenna and it will emit some radiation. So in all these scenario, here you can see the wave is dealing with electric and magnetic field. Here the signal is dealing with voltage and current. Okay, so these are the main difference which you already know. I am just brushing up before going into deep. Okay, so what is antenna? So antenna, you already aware that it will change the electrical signal into electromagnetic waves, and similarly it is capable of receiving electromagnetic waves and it will change it into electrical signals. Okay, so these kind of things you already aware of. And before going to antenna, I will just quickly give a just fundamental basics of radio frequency, that is RF fundamentals. So yeah, imagine you have a metal rod. Okay, so this is a metal rod of 12.5 centimeter. Okay, and I'm giving a DC voltage to it. Okay, and the other end is open, just I'm giving a DC. Okay, and if I measure what is the charge across it throughout the conductor, in everywhere it will be plus charge because we given positive of the DC. And if you plot that charge density, and we can see like this, so throughout it will be plus, okay, because we given DC. Imagine in the same metal rod I given an RF signal, which is 2.5 gigahertz RF signal. It can be either from Bluetooth transmitter, or it can be from Wi-Fi. All these things uses 2.4 gigahertz. Okay, so what will happen now? At that time, if we check, the charge density will be like this. Somewhere it will be zero, somewhere it will be more positive, and here it will be zero again. Here some negative will be there, and here again it will be zero. So if you plot that charge density with respect to the length of the conductor, you will get like this. Okay, so this will happen only if we apply a RF signal. So why this is happening now? Because we have chosen 12.5 centimeter, which is the exact wavelength of 2.4 gigahertz. So we can simply calculate wavelength equal to lambda equal to C by F, where C is speed of light. So if you put 2.4 gigahertz, you will get 12.5 centimeter. So for a 12.5 centimeter metal rod, if you give a RF signal like this, you can see the voltage distribution, or we can see that charge distribution will be like this. Okay, so now you may understand what will happen to the charges if you give a DC and also if you give an RF signal. Okay, so similarly, if you take a 1 meter length, it will be like this. Charge distribution will be like this. Okay, so people may ask, this side is open. What will happen this side if I connect some load or something? So in that time, you can see like this. If I take a same 1 meter length or something, and if I give a RF signal this end, and if I give a load here, the current flow will be like this. It will not be a uniform. It will be also sinusoidally distributed. Okay, and imagine if this load, if I removed like this, then you can see, just consider this green line. It is going forward, and after a particular time it reaches the end, and it don't have any path to go. So what would it will happen? The entire wave will flow back. So you can see the blue line. So as a result, it will somewhere it will add up together, and somewhere it will be zero. So this is called standing wave. So I'm not going deep on this. This is the entire topic, so I'm not covering this. I'm just giving an intro. Okay, so I told that I am a certified trainer for MathCAD, no? So in that MathCAD only, I draw all these graphs. So it will be easy for engineers to represent visually while we have some equations and all. So moving forward. So can I, as of now, any query is there? I think, sorry, your voice is so feeble. Yeah, hello. Sir, your voice is so low.
Sir, can I come again? No, sir, it's too low.
Yeah, now I can hear you. Yeah, can you please come again? Actually, it's not free software. It is licensable software. Maybe for 30 days, if you enter your college details, you can get a 30 days free for a single person. So maybe that will be sufficient for yeah, some kind of knowledge transfer. Maybe I will check you on that offline. So for students, there are a lot of math software apart from MathCAD and MATLAB. So you can just explore yourself. So whatever equations you have, you can just visually plot it on anywhere. So I will, if time allows, I will show you all these math kind of softwares. Okay. So can I get, so few people are already aware of antenna. So can I get an answer from a student? What is the minimum length of an antenna? If you are going to give a signal of lambda, what is the minimum length of an antenna? How much it should be? So any students, can you please chat or you can just. Yep. Okay. Okay, I will explain. Okay, so we have studied that the antenna length should be at least lambda by 4. Okay, so consider an dipole antenna like this. Okay, so this is going to emit 2.4 gigahertz. Okay, so this is a PCB and here this is the traces. So whatever metal on above the PCB, we call it as a trace. Okay, so here what we have to do is the total dipole length should be lambda by 2 and individually the dipole the individual pole should be lambda by 4. So we have studied from this from the beginning itself, but we don't know why exactly why we need lambda by 4. Okay, so for a 2.4 gigahertz input, the lambda by 4 will be 3.1 centimeter. So if you arrange a setup like this, then this will be sufficient to radiate a signal of 2.4 gigahertz. So I will tell you how this will be radiating. Okay, so initially, I already told that the length should be lambda by 4. Okay, because if you take a sine wave as input, so all RF signal will be sine wave. So it will be always sine wave. There is no square wave or sawtooth wave RF signal. All signal will be sine wave. So if you take a lambda by if you take a sine wave with a lambda means a total wavelength. Here you can see this is lambda by 4. So in the lambda by 4, what is happening? The signal is changing from 0 to its maximum. Similarly, in next lambda by 4 cycle, it is coming from maximum to 0 again. So here you can see again in next lambda by 4 cycle, it is going to minus maximum, that is a negative peak from its zero, and again it is going to zero. So all these major changes of a sine wave is happening for lambda by 4 cycle. So that's why we need a dipole or a pole should be lambda, antenna length should be lambda by 4. So I will be explaining you in detail what will happen to antenna if we give all these cycles. Okay, so initially how the antenna will be, consider this same example, two poles, lambda by 4, two poles, and it is fitted with a RF signal. So consider that. So initially it will be ground and here it will be zero voltage. So in first quarter of my signal, like this, from zero to maximum it is changing. So in that stage what will happen? Previously it was zero voltage. Now it started building positive charges like this. Okay, why? Because it is changing from zero voltage to its maximum peak. Okay, which is in positive. So that's why we are getting positive charges like this. Okay, so whenever a positive charges is like this and here it is ground, there will be an electric field distribution like this. You can see here arrow mark is down. So from this plate to this plate, there will be some electric field distribution like this. Okay, and what will happen in the next stage? It will change from maximum to its zero. So in that case, what will happen? So whatever the field will go a little bit, it will travel a little bit, and after that, whatever field developed, it will get collapsed. Okay, and it will become a loop. And in next cycle, from 0 to negative maximum it is going. So what will happen, instead of positive charges, here it will develop a negative charges. And here you can see the arrow mark is opposite direction. From ground to negative plate, it is going like this. Okay, and in next cycle, what will happen? It will make another loop. So overall, if you're giving a continuous sine wave, the antenna will be radiating like this. So here you can see it is making, keep on making electric field loop, and it is propagating through air. So if you can visualize, I think this will be enough for visualizing. So here you can see antenna is changing its current, which means the charges is changing. And as a result, the electric field is keep on changing. So we all know whenever the electric field changes, it will create a magnetic field. So along with this electric field, magnetic field also will be there, which will be perpendicular. So if you understand in terms of only electric field, then don't look into magnetic field. It will make you some confusion. So if you stick on to electric field, it is fine. So hope everybody understands. Maybe I just want to understand why lambda by 4 we need, and how the electric field and how it will be radiated. So I think it is clear for everyone. Okay, so these are the practical dipole antennas which we will use in industries. So here you can see this is some of one of the radio antenna. So radio frequencies are less in megahertz range. So that's why if you take the lambda by 4, it will be huge. The antenna will be huge. So here we will use for some 2.4 gigahertz. It, frequency is high. So its antenna size became reduced, and we can accommodate in a PCB. Okay, and the emitted radiation will be, radiation pattern will be like this. So imagine this is my antenna. If I place like this, the radiation pattern will be around that. Okay, so this is the radiation pattern which we plot in 3D. So in industry, we will, for deeper analysis, what we will do is we will cut this radiation pattern like this, and we will get a side view or the cross section view like this. And also we will analyze from top. So if we analyze from top, it will be like this. So here you can see, if I cut like this, I will get a 2D radiation pattern like this. And if I look from top, I will get a circle like this. Okay, so this is side view and top view. So in industry, we call it as azimuth and elevation. So it is not needed for you now. So here, just one more example. So if a person is standing here, he will get the range, or he will get the radiation. And if a person standing here, which means some higher altitude in some building, so he will not get a range. So we, from this image itself, we can understand that the radiation is going only to the certain degree. So if a person is in 30 degree of this antenna around here, he will get a radiation. And if a person is in 90 degree, he will not get the radiation. So everything, the radiation, the flow of radiation will be with respect to the surrounding or the degree, 360 degree. So that's why we are measuring power level versus degree. So yeah, that's all. So going detail into antenna parameters, there are some antenna parameters or antenna specifications which we will use in industries. So yeah, I'm going to that. Do you have any queries or do you have any other concerns? Okay, sir, do you have anything to add up? Yeah, okay. So antenna parameters. Okay, so I told that I'm an antenna design engineer, and I will be designing antenna. So while I'm giving this antenna to the customer, he will ask what are the specifications of this antenna. So I have to tell them that this is this will radiate like this. So they will have, what we follow is, we will have a set of parameters or a set of specifications which is used to characterize our antenna. So first one is gain or directivity. So both are somewhat same. That's why I am clubbed together. Okay. So imagine you have a bulb like this or a lamp like this. It will emit radiation or a light in all direction. No? So it is called omnidirectional. So if you check in 360 degree, the light wave will travel in both all 360 degree. Okay. And imagine you have a flashlight or torch. So here you can see the beam is focused in one direction. Okay. It is called directive radiation. So what is the difference between these two? One is the degree which the light radiation is covering. And here you can see, since it is giving radiation to all direction, each degree will get only less radiation. But here you can see all the radiation will add up in the front and the beam will be stronger in particular direction. Okay. So likewise, the antenna also, sometimes we have to design antenna in this manner. Okay. So imagine I have an antenna and I have to communicate with Ahalya. So it is 40 kilometer apart from here. Okay. So at that time, what I have to do is I have only one user, which is Ahalya. So what I will do is I will, in top of my house, I will fix a high gain antenna, which is focusing only into the direction where Ahalya is situated. Similarly, Ahalya also will have a receiving antenna, which is also highly directive in a particular, which will be arranged such that it will see in the direction where my house is. Okay. So in that case, I have to use these kind of antenna. And imagine like a mobile tower. So mobile tower don't know where the user will be. So it has to give radiation in all direction. So the tower don't know where the user is. So it should receive and transmit direction radiation in all directions. So that's why we use omnidirectional for that purpose and the directive antenna for some other purpose. Okay. So in car also, in vehicle, automotive vehicle also, here you can see, I don't know whether it is visible. Here there is one antenna, automotive antenna. So after manufacturing, we have to test how much a gain or radiation is there for that particular antenna. For that, what we will do is, we will set up a room called anechoic chamber. So in anechoic chamber, you can see a sharp rubber-like structure. Okay, so why we are using this now? It will accept all the radiation which we give. So there will not be any reflection from the walls. So imagine if you are in a closed loop house or somewhere, and you are testing your antenna. So you will get a lot of reflection from your wall and nearby cupboard, everything. So it will give you a false information of your antenna. Okay. So what we have to do is we have to check our antenna, or we have to test our antenna in an anechoic chamber. So there will not be any reflection from the walls. So because all the walls are manufactured with a rubberized, and it will be a pointing outside. So it is capable of accepting, or it will capable of giving a less reflections. Okay. So from here, we will place our car, and what we will do is we will rotate this entire structure. So here you can see lot of receiving antennas are there. So based on the information which you got from that antenna, we will plot our gain or directivity. So here you can see, this is just an example. So we will rotate that particular structure, and we will plot the radiation pattern based on the power level which we received in this receiving antennas. Okay. So this is the radiation pattern of a particular antenna. Okay. So it's just basics. It's just a power level versus degree. Okay. And next I'm going to frequency, impedance and return loss. So all these things are somewhat relatable. So that's why I clubbed it together. So imagine I have a RF transmitter. Okay. So all RF transmitter will be will have the output impedance of 50 ohms. Okay, previously, long back, it was 75 ohms. After that, it was 30 ohms. Now we are following the algebraic sum, that is arithmetic sum of both 75 and 30. So we get almost 50 ohms. Okay, so it is a universally accepted impedance. Okay, so every RF transmitter will have a output impedance of 50 ohm. And if you consider my load as an antenna, so this antenna should be designed for input impedance of 50 ohm. Then only maximum power transfer will happen. Okay, so whatever RF transmitter is giving will be accepted by this 50 ohm antenna. Okay, so for that demonstration, imagine I am giving a 2.4 gigahertz RF signal from RF transmitter to antenna. It is 1 watt. So imagine like that, it is 1 watt. Okay, and this antenna is designed for 2.4 gigahertz and its input is 50 ohm. So at that time, what will happen? Most of the energy will be radiated and only a few 0.001 watt will be reflected back to RF transmitter. Okay, similarly, if I give a 6 gigahertz 1 watt signal to a 2.4 gigahertz antenna, it is not the impedance will not match properly. So at that time, what will happen? No, 0.99 watt, or that is a maximum reflection will occur at that time. So here you can see 1 watt we have given and the 99% of the power got reflected back. Only a few will be transmitting or it will be radiating. Okay, so now you understand the relation between the frequency and impedance. Okay, and what in industry what we will do is we will check the difference between what power we have given and how much reflection we got, and we will take a ratio. So that ratio is called return loss. Okay, and you people already aware of S parameter, S11, S12. So return loss means just S11, whatever power we are giving to a single port and how much power we are reflecting back. This S11 should be, actually it should be very low. Very low means only that much reflection we got. If it is too high, then at that time, most of the power is reflected back, nothing is transmitted. Okay, so here you can see, this is called network analyzer, which we use in industry to check whether antenna is propagating, I mean antenna is radiating properly or not. So what it will do is, it will have two ports. So in one of the port, we will take it and we will connect to our antenna. Okay, and it will give some, if imagine this antenna is designed for 2.4 gigahertz. And what I will do is, I will give input from 1 gigahertz to 4 gigahertz to this antenna. And I will check how much reflection is happening for each frequency. Okay, and I will plot that. Okay, and finally, the graph will be looking like this. Okay, so with respect to frequency, I will check what is my return loss. Okay, so return loss will be in dB. So in RF, everything will be in decibel. Linear will be very much difficult to plot in graph. So we will use decibel. Okay. So here you can see in 1 gigahertz, the return loss is 0. 0 dB means 1. So whatever power you have given, it is reflected back. So if you take the ratio, it will be 1. It will, if you express in decibel, it will be 0. So in 1 gigahertz signal, if you give, the reflection is maximum. And you can see here in 2.4 gigahertz, the reflection is only minus 40 dB, which means only 0.001, that much reflection only it is there. Okay, so if we have given 2.4 gigahertz signal and we don't get any reflection. So what it mean? All the signals got transmitted into space. Okay, all the powers we given is transmitted, converted into electromagnetic wave, and it is transmitted to space. So that's why we are not getting reflection in that particular frequency. So what customer will do, no? Customer will check at what frequency it is resonating, So we will get, we will come to know that, okay, I designed for 2.4 gigahertz and it is exactly resonating at 2.4 gigahertz. So the first parameter frequency is passing. Okay, next the impedance. So if the impedance match, then only we will get less reflection. So here from this y-axis, we can come to know that the reflection is very much less here. Okay, some customer will ask for 12 dB and few customer will ask for minus 10 dB. So here you can see, if it check the 10 dB line here, from 2.3 gigahertz to 2.5 gigahertz, my antenna is radiating. Okay, so that is my bandwidth. Okay, so here you can see frequency is okay, impedance is okay, my bandwidth is okay. And similarly, S11, the customer asked for minus 12 dB or minus 10 dB, like that we have to check. So if customer asked for minus 10 dB, we can say like this antenna is capable for that particular specification. Because see here you can see from 2.3 gigahertz to 2.5 gigahertz, it is radiating. It is giving only less reflection. Okay, so don't go in detail about that. Just a basic, okay? We are just measuring what is the reflected power with respect to frequency. That's all. Okay, so apart from that, that network analyzer is capable for plotting Smith chart also. So Smith chart means what it will do is, here you can see, this is some Smith chart, and here 50 ohm will be there. Okay, so our if we plot this Smith chart and over the frequency, like here you can see, so I will check from 400 megahertz to 4 gigahertz. I will plot and I can see here, it is now, it is in this frequency, it is close to 50 ohms. Okay, so my antenna is designed for this frequency. Okay, and remaining all frequency, you can see here, if it is lying below this Smith chart, my antenna is more capacitive. Okay, so in from this 1.8 gigahertz to 400 megahertz, my antenna is more capacitive. It is not working as antenna, it is just a capacitor. Okay, and if a customer asks to make that antenna work for this particular frequency range, what I have to do is I have to add additional inductor. Okay, so once again I will repeat, this is just a impedance plotting with respect to frequency. Okay, so here you can see this is the already measured data, and here you can see as I previously mentioned, this will be 50 ohm here, but when we checking, only few frequency is satisfying that 50 ohm, remaining became more capacitive. Okay, so it became more capacitive. So to nullify that capacitance, what we have to do is, before giving RF signal to antenna, we have to add one inductor. Okay, so this is called matching network. So if your load is too capacitive, you have to add inductance. If you are in this graph, you can see it is in top hemisphere, so which means your antenna is more inductive. So to make it matching, so what we have to do is we have to add additional capacitor. So this is the entire different topic which is called a matching network. So I'm not going detail about that. So I hope you are aware of what is frequency of antenna, impedance of antenna, and return loss of antenna. Okay, this is sufficient for you. So going to the next parameter, it is called antenna efficiency. Okay, so here you can see, this is my antenna and this is my RF signal. Okay, if I give some 1 watt of RF signal, even though if the antenna is properly matched, there will be a small reflection. Okay, it will be there, always it will be there. Okay, ideally only it, we can consider that all there is zero reflection. So in real life it will be there. So here if we check the efficiency here, efficiency will be what is the transmitted antenna, what is the reflect, what is it is just a ratio between what goes inside and what goes outside. Okay, so here itself, at the starting itself, we have a efficiency. We have to take care on that design. Okay, and once the RF signal entered into antenna, we all know antenna will be some metal or some other substrate material, so it will have some losses internally. Some losses will be there, so because of that losses, maybe the signal get distorted or it will get it will be dissipated as heat. Okay, so because of that, some power will be dissipated. Okay, because of loss, and the other power, no, the remaining power is accepted inside antenna and it will be radiated. Okay, so here one more efficiency will come. So here one efficiency and here one more efficiency. So here we have to adjust that efficiency by properly setting our impedance. Okay, and here what we have to do is we have to choose the proper material, and most of the antenna material will be chosen or it will be fabricated by other suppliers. So we have to choose the supplier properly. Okay, so here one more thing you can see here. In the near surrounding, antenna radiation will be like a curved nature, and as it go with respect to time, after a few length, it seems to be became a straight line. Okay, that is the basic nature of wave. Okay, so here if you put an antenna like this, it will not be able to capture that curved signal. Okay, so that region is called near field. So where the electric fields will be curved, okay, and after some time, that is the far field, the line became straight line. So because of this only, if you have a Wi-Fi router and if you sit very close to it, you will not get a proper power level. The power transmission will be delayed further, and if you go beyond that far field, you will get a proper reception of signal. Okay, so I just want to convey only these two things. Just we have, if the impedance mismatch is there, power reflection will be there, and based on the material which we used in antenna, we will have a power losses. Okay, these two are the main things we have to understand. Okay. Okay, so next I'm going to types of automotive antennas. So if you have any queries, you can just ask at any time, no issue. You can interrupt me at any time. Okay, so guys, you have seen the backside of car like this. Okay, so this is called a heater element. Okay, some people may aware of it. So while we manufacture the car, it should work in all climatic condition. So imagine if we are going to use the car in Kashmir, so there the temperature will be very low. So at that time, what will happen? In the glass, there will be a formation of fog. So what we will do is we will give a current to this copper coils. So this copper coil will heat up and it will remove that fog formation. Okay. So later we came to know that this is actually a metal, right? So in this metal, we can actually fabricate some antennas. This is the best place for antennas too. Okay. So along with that heater, we can add antenna also. So as a result, what will happen? We can receive FM, AM, and other digital signals also we can receive. Okay. So it will not affect our beauty of our car or aesthetic of our car. It is just integrated with our heater. So we can receive AM, FM, and other digital signals. So this is the one of the antenna which we will use in car. Okay, and we call it as rear, since it is a rear side, rear windshield antenna. Okay, so next, shark fin antenna. So you guys already aware, you have seen these beautiful antennas which will be placed in the top of modern cars. Okay, so inside this car, there will be a GPS antenna like this, which is a patch antenna. So I will explain you how the patch antenna is working in later slide. So just you understand what all things are inside each antennas. Okay, so here, if you open, you can see one patch antenna will be there here, and along with that one more antenna will be there. So this antenna is used for connected car system or V2X. If you don't know, V2X is just a vehicle to vehicle communication. So in future, in near future, all car can communicate with each other. So imagine if you are in a traffic signal and one car is at the beginning, okay, and you are at the last, okay. So once the traffic signal changed to some other emergency or ambulance mode or anything, the first car which can see that can give information to the remaining car, okay. So the car itself will communicate each other in future, okay. So this will help for some autopilot mode which already Tesla introduced, okay. So for that purpose we need a communication between each car. For that we will use this antenna, okay. So next we can see in the that plastic casing of that shark fin antenna, there will be another antenna like this which will be used for some satellite radio reception, okay. So all these antennas will be inside this particular shark fin antenna, okay. So going to next, so we all know the rear view mirror. So if you check inside the rear view mirror, there will be some antennas. So it will be used for some cellular network reception like 2G, 3G, 4G, or similarly the vehicle to vehicle communication, okay. So behind the rear view mirror also we can integrate antennas, okay. So next, we all know we use as remote cars. Now we use as remote to access our cars, okay. So both in remote side and also inside the car, there should be an antenna. Then only that communication will happen. So mostly what we will do is we will use a monopole antenna. So here you can see monopole antenna means a simple, just a conductor, just a metal conductor with a lambda by 4 length, okay. So if this lambda by 4 is too high, at that time what we will do, we will just make it a zigzag manner, which we call it as mirrored antenna, okay. So there is a there are some theory to find this length and the spacing everything, but I'm not going deep into it. So instead of a straight line, we can use a mirrored shape like this. So this will give you, maybe it can give you a higher bandwidth and higher performance also, okay. And the radiation pattern will be like this. So previously we have seen radiation pattern of dipole, which is like an donut shape, or it will be in omnidirectional in all up and bottom. So here you can see the most of the radiation is in top side. Why? Because the bottom side is a ground plane like this, okay. So because of that, most of the radiation will be concentrated on the top side, okay. So this is called a mirrored monopole antenna. So next, you can see this is the most commonly used rooftop antenna. So inside the rooftop, it will be a helical antenna. Okay. So personally, I like helical antenna very much. Why? Because I'll show you. So as I told that we have some simulation tools like HFSS, CST, and other tools also there. So in that tool, we can simulate and see what is the radiation pattern. We can draw it like mechanical cadence app. They also uses no mechanical cadence software. Similarly, we can also draw antennas and we can simulate it to see what are the radiations. So here you can see and this helical antenna has three modes mainly. If the loop is very small, then the radiation will be like dipole antenna, which I have shown previously. If I increase the radius further, then you can see instead of getting this kind of radiation, all the radiation will be concentrated in the in this axis direction, okay. So by simply changing the radius, we can concentrate more radiation in a particular particular direction. So this is called axial mode. Apart from that, if you do some more changes, we will get a the higher order mode like this. So we can actually frame our radiation pattern, frame our electromagnetic waves by simply changing the radius of this helix. Okay, so this is very interesting. So this is also used for FM cellular network and other applications, and the radiation pattern will be like looking like this. So as I told that, this is the simulation result of this helical antenna, which is showing the radiation pattern. Okay, so as of now in value, we don't have antenna simulation tools, so that's why it can't show you directly. And all these things are from the Google and from my previous companies. Okay, so going to the important topic called phased array concept. So before that, anything is there? Any doubt you have, or anything you want me to repeat? Can I go ahead? Okay, I'm proceeding. So phased array antenna. So this is the very important and interesting topic ever in engineering. If you ask, I would say like that. So what is phased array antenna? Okay, so instead of using one particular antenna, we can use an array of antenna. Array means a group of antenna. So here you can see this is one array. Here it is one another array, and combined it is a 2D array. So instead of one particular antenna, we can use multiple antenna. So based on that, based on the number and based on the spacing between this antenna, the entire radiation pattern will change. So that is a concept called array. Okay, so why phased array? I will explain you in depth of this phased array antenna, because I worked for this antenna more than 1 year. So why we used phased array antenna in vehicle? Okay, so this kind of phased array antenna radar we will use in front of vehicle, just above number plate or somewhere, and it will continuously, it will transmit some RF signals in the order of some 70 gigahertz or 77 gigahertz. So based on the that signal will be touching, or it will be interacting with the obstacle in front, and based on the reflection from that signal, we can actually plot, the car will understand how many obstacles are there, whether it is moving or not, or if it is moving, what is the speed of that obstacle. So all these things the car itself will come to know. So before hitting anything, the car itself will initiate the braking system. And I am also working for autonomous driving. Autonomous driving means without driver. So without driver itself, car started driving now. So you guys are already aware of autopilot. So this will help for that facility also. Okay, so mainly we are using this for anti-collision, which means we should not make any collision with obstacle. So before that, the vehicle should stop. Okay, so I will give you how to design this phased array antenna and what is the performance of this phased array antenna. Okay, so what is radar? In some Hollywood movies we have seen this in top of one vehicle, one huge antenna will be there, placed there, and it will be keep on rotating. And why we are using that dish kind of antenna? Because this kind of antenna will give you more focused beam. Okay, so it will be more focused beam, and it will be keep on rotating. Okay, it will be keep on rotating, and based on the reflection from the obstacle, we can see here, you can see, we can see whether any target or any obstacle is there in front or not. Okay, this is the traditional system which we used long back. Okay, so this have a lot of disadvantages, we all already know. It need mechanical rotation, and it will create a lot of noises. So for mechanical rotation, power loss will be there. So it is very difficult to manufacture. And also these kind of things we cannot introduce in our car, because modern car needs some more aesthetics, or more, it should be more presentable or beautiful. Okay, so these kind of things we cannot use it. So what is the solution for this? Okay, so one solution for high gain. Okay, so we are using that heavy dish kind of parabolic antenna to get more gain. Gain means the beam focused in a particular direction. So for getting that, instead of one, this is a patch antenna. For those who don't understand, this is patch antenna. So if you use that single, it will be single patch antenna. We are using n number of patch antenna, so it is called array of patch antenna. Okay, so if you use this kind of array of patch antenna, this I simulated in HFSS and I got result like this. Okay, you can see here the beam is focused in a particular direction. In all other direction, it got cancelled. So in first year, you may study it, what is the waves will get add up, like constructive interference and destructive interference are there. So here you can see in the top of antenna, all the energy will be constructive interference and it will add up together. In all the other direction, it will be cancelled. So we have to design in a such a way by adjusting the spacing between each antenna. So that I will explain you in detail in next slide. So if we use a multiple patch antenna or patch antenna array, we got a solution for high gain. So we can remove that bulky parabolic antenna and we can simply use some PCB antenna like this. Okay, then next solution, how we will rotate that PCB. Okay, for that purpose, what we will do is we will use phased array concept. Okay, so here you can see I have a lot of antenna like this. Okay, and instead of giving RF signal equally to all, what I will do is I will slightly change the phase of each antenna. So here you can see it will start at the beginning, and later this one, like that, finally this one. Okay, and so you can see here this beam, this radiation will be more advanced and this will be more slowed. And here you can see it will add up in, it will be, the beam got tilted. Okay, so by simply controlling the phase, input phase of the signal, RF signal, we can get beam in different direction. Okay, so here you can see this is also HFSS simulation which I have done. What I have done is I have given RF signal first to the this set of antenna, and later after few phase delay I have given here. So like that I have progressively I have given. So here you can see the beam got tilted. Similarly, if I give in opposite direction, the beam will get tilted opposite direction. Okay, so this is okay for everyone. If you don't have any tool, if you don't have any RF tool or a simulation tool, just go to Excel sheet. Okay, go to Excel sheet and simply I will show you one equation. Simply we have to use this equation. So I will show you that. So here you can see what is the frequency, what is the lambda and spacing, and here number of antenna, and also here amount of phase shift I have given. Okay, so here I'm going to give zero antenna. So zero antenna means no radiation. Okay, so it is making sense. So next, one antenna. So I think it is visible for everyone, right? Do I need to zoom further? Yeah, I think it is a yes.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, okay, okay, fine. So here, if I give one antenna, see the radiation is in all direction. So it is omnidirectional. Okay, or we can say isotropically radiated. If I give five antenna, see the beam get concentrated in particular direction. If I give 15 antennas, the beam became more narrow and it is focusing more and more to a particular direction. If I give 150 antennas, see, it became very narrow and we call it as a like a pencil beam, like that we call. Okay, so for example, you choose 20 antennas like this, and all the energy is concentrated in this particular direction. And next I'm going to change the phase shift. Okay, so now it is zero. So what I will do is, I will here, for example, if I give zero, all these antennas will be energized at a single time. Okay, if I give a 10 degree phase shift, what will happen now? This will come out first, and after a few 10 degree of phase shift, this will come, and like that it will be progressively, it will decrease. So I'm going to give 30 degree phase shift and see the beam got tilted. Similarly, if I give 60 degree, it got tilted to another degree. Okay, and if I'm going to give minus 60 degree, so the beam got tilted. So simply, I'm going to presentation again. Okay, so simply changing the phase, we can control the beam, we can steer the beam without any mechanical rotation. So I think you guys understand that. I will come again. So we can use PCB antenna instead of dish antenna. So only thing is, instead of one particular antenna, we have to use multiple antenna, so it will form an array. So it will be very directive, and by controlling the phase given to it, we can actually steer the beam like this. So no need of any mechanical rotation. So instead of a bulky radar, we can actually minimize into a PCB radar. Okay, so I will tell you how to design step by step on this. Okay, so first of all, step one, design a patch antenna. So we all know patch antenna is the single unit of that array. So we have to design that first. So here you can see, this is the patch antenna, how it will be. First of all, one substrate will be there. This white color is the substrate, which is the PCB material. So above that, we will place our patch antenna, which will be made up of copper. And below that, fully it will be covered with the ground. Okay, so for understanding, I will explain with the side view. Okay, so this is the side view, and I am going to feed my RF signal at the center. Here I am going to feed. So hope everyone can see this. So I am going to feed my RF signal at the center by giving ground here. Okay, so at that time, what will happen now? This is my RF signal, and this patch width, I have choose like it will be lambda by 2, and here I am going to feed my signal. So what will happen now, where I feed my signal, there it will be zero, and remaining here and here it will be distributed like this. So here maximum Vmax will come, and in this corner minus Vmax will come. Okay, so don't go in detail about that. Just understand that here maximum will come, and here negative maximum, that is the minus negative peak will come in voltage. Okay, so at that time what will happen, here it is more positive and here it is ground. So always there will be a electric field attraction in downwards like this. Okay, after reaching center, what will happen, here it is negative Vmax, negative voltage is there, so here it is ground, which is zero. So from ground, it will, the electric field will be in opposite direction. It will go to the patch like this. Okay, and here you can see inside the patch, the amount of electric field is opposite, equal and opposite. You can see here, if there is a down arrow, here there will be an up arrow. So it will cancel each other. So inside patch antenna, the field will get cancel each other. But you can see here in corner, here, since it is a Vmax, some fringing field will come outside like this. Okay, so fringing field will come here, and it will be the direction will be in like this, left side. And here also you can see some fringing field will come here. See, consider this arrow and this arrow. This is equal, but it is not opposite. Okay, so it will not cancel each other. It will add up together. So there is no provision for canceling each other. So it will add up together. So what happened if those electric field add up together? No, so it will propagate into space. So in HFSS, you can see how these all this voltage, charge, everything is distributed in 2D. We can see in a radiation manner. So here in the first cycle, the current will add up in this direction, and in next cycle it will add up in that direction. It will keep on oscillating. So that oscillating wave electric field will create a radiation pattern, and a person looking from top of it will see like this. Okay, so this is the radiation pattern of a single patch antenna. So here you can see the beam width is very high, so from around 60 degrees there. So single patch antenna, we cannot use it for high gain application. So for that, what we have to do, we have to do multiple antennas. Okay, and if you don't, if you still want more information on how to design an antenna, I will tell you like this. So first of all, consider your width calculate your width using this formula. Okay, this is your frequency. Remaining everything will be a constant. So here epsilon r is the substrate material. So once you purchase the substrate material, in its data sheet it will be there. What is the epsilon r, which is the permittivity constant, dielectric constant. So next, what we have to do, we have to set the length. Okay, based on this equation, you can set the length. So and next, behind substrate there is a ground, I said. So that ground width also we have to choose. So based on this equation, you can choose. So if you all these things you have calculated, after fabrication your patch antenna will be looking like this. Okay, fine. So next, step two, we have designed a single element. Then what we have to do, we have to make an array. So instead of single antenna, we have to use a multiple antenna, and each antenna should be placed lambda by 2 distance. We should not exceed apart from that. So I will tell you what will happen if we exceed that. And similarly, we have to do 2D array. That also should be spaced lambda by 2. Okay, so after manufacturing, it will be looking like this. So we can see lot of patch antenna. It is separated by a distance of lambda by 2. Okay, so based on your application, you can choose how to feed your antenna, like coaxial feed, microstrip feed. Here it is a microstrip feed. So coaxial, lot of feeds are there. It is not applicable for you right now. So after all fabrication, it will be looking like this. Okay, so step three, what we have to do, we have to precisely calculate how much phase shift we have to give. So some customer will tell like their beam should go from 100 degree to 100 degree beam width, it should go like that, they will tell. Okay, some customer will tell that they need only 60 degree. So based on the customer specification, we have to design, we have to calculate how much phase shift is needed, as I shown in that Excel sheet. Okay, then what we have to do is we have to design a phase shifter module. So this is a phase shifter module. So this IC is capable. Imagine if I give a sine wave like this, and based on the input what I have given, the phase will get changed. Okay, so this will be connected to some processor or microcontroller. So they will give some commands such that my phase will get delayed, or it will lag or need. Okay, so this is called phase shifter module. Okay, it is controlled digitally, so we call it as digital phase shifter module. Okay, so what we have to do, we have a bunch of patch antenna, and antenna array is there, and each antenna array will be controlled by digital phase shifter modules. And what input amount of phase shift to that in digital phase shifter will be given through digital communication, and it will be connected to processor. Okay, so the processor will give command how much phase shift need to be given, and inside processor we have a phase shifting coding or algorithm. like that we have some programs. So that program will drive, so the end result is like that, the program will drive the amount of radiation. Okay, I think it is okay for everyone. So I will repeat once again. So we have array of antenna, and we have digital phase shifters like this. So based on the phase shifting, the beam will get tilted. Okay, so this phase shifters will be controlled by processor, and this processor will be working as per the code inside that. Okay, that's all. So by this, we made actually a transmitting radar. Okay, so what is the main advantage of this? We have replaced a bulky parabolic antenna, which is a movable antenna, with a simple PCB antenna. So this PCB antenna, you no need to move, because through digital phase shifting, what we will do, the beam itself will move, beam itself will steer. So no need of mechanical things needed. So whenever we avoid mechanical things, the life of the module will increase. So warranty will increase. So more customer will get attracted to that product. Okay. So in general, this is the traditional technology, and this is the modern technology. Okay. So this modern technology has one drawback. Okay. So in the starting, I told that patch to patch distance or antenna to antenna distance should be lambda by 2. So imagine if I exceed lambda by 2, what will happen now? You can see here, one lobe is here and another main lobe is here. So instead of one focused beam, two beams are coming. If you increase further, multiple beams will come. So this is called grating lobes. Okay, so this grating lobe should not come, because imagine here my obstacle is there. Here no obstacle is there, but here some trees are there. Okay, and we will get two reflection from here and also from here. So our system will think that reflection from tree is another vehicle in front, and it will give to a misinformation, or it will give a fault information. Okay, so at that time your autopilot mode or self-driving mode will not work. So all these things lies on how much spacing you have given between the antennas. Okay, so that's the complete thing on the phased array antenna. Okay, so coming to next, so I will show you one RF board. So this is the RF board. So here you can see lot of tiny ICs are there, and capacitor are there, and MOSFET are there. Apart from all this, you can see some other structures like this. Okay, see here. So what it is now, these all are filters. Okay, so mostly what we will do, we will create a filter using either inductor or capacitor, but here it is only traces are there. Okay, why? Because I will zoom little more. So here you can see some traces is coming like this, and it is going to ground. Okay, and after a spacing, again another trace is there, and it is going to ground. So as a result, what will happen now? So one trace is coming, and it is shorting to ground. So that particular trace will act as an inductor. Okay, after that one spacing is there, so spacing will act as capacitor. Okay, so again inductor, capacitor. So like that, this, by controlling the spacing and also the amount of length of this particular trace, we can actually create inductor and also capacitor. Okay, so that's why this is a board of a spectrum analyzer, which is dealing with some 18 gigahertz or more than that. So if the frequency increased at that time, we don't need any inductor or capacitor. The trace itself will act as inductor and capacitor. So this is an extra headache for engineers also, because we have to carefully choose the trace width and trace length and trace spacing, because Otherwise, it will act as inductor or capacitor, which will give you additional impedance. Okay, and here also you can see this is called interdigited filter, and here you can see this is a radial filter. So all these things are working in same manner. So whatever things we have given, no, this is called stub. So this extra metal piece is called stub, and this is capable of giving you additional impedance in the form of capacitance or inductance. Okay, I know this is a very huge topic for you guys, but just giving you an introduction to that. Okay, so apart from that, okay, so this is the MathCAD tool which I used. Okay, so as I already told that in Valio, we don't have any other simulation tools like HFSS or CST. So we have purchased it and it will be getting by January, but as of now we don't have tool. So what I will do is I will use MathCAD as a simulator. Okay, so in this simulator what I will do is I know the equations for electric field of for example, I designed this document for a half dipole antenna. So what I will do now, I know how to calculate my lambda, how to calculate the electric field, and everything I know. So what I will do is I will simply plot all these things here. Okay, so here you can see the radiation pattern which I got, I actually plotted here. Okay, only because I know the equations. So once you know the equations of antenna, you can plot it. Okay, if you don't know the equation at that time, you have to use HFSS or CST. So at that time, the simulator itself will create some equation and it will plot. Okay, so going, so what I have done now, I choose one dipole antenna, and in first case, what I have done is antenna length I have taken as lambda by 2, and I plotted like this. Okay, so I got a radiation pattern like this. And in next case, what I have done is I increased lambda by, I changed lambda by 2 to lambda. So at that time, my radiation pattern is like this. It is more concentrated in particular direction. If you see in 3D, it will be like this. Okay, so it became more narrow. Next, what I am going to do is, instead of 1 lambda, I given 1.25 lambda. That is 1 lambda plus quarter lambda again. So here you can see some additional lobes started generating. Okay, similarly, I increased further to 2 lambda. So see, the radiation pattern entirely it got changed. Okay, so this kind of radiation pattern is very useful for some 5G antennas. Why? Because imagine this is my tower, okay, and I have only 4 users, one in here, one in here, one in here, and here. So in that case, I can use this antenna. So instead of giving radiation to all direction, I can actually choose my path. So the radiation will go only to the specific user. So that is a high-end application, so it is not needed here. So if I increase further, see, it became like this. So actually we can play with radiation pattern like this in if you get any simulation tools like this. Okay, if you don't have any simulation tool, even in simple Excel sheet also we can plot this equations. Okay, so I think I almost covered. Yeah, thank you. Any query is there?
Sir, good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Sir, I'm Sugapriya from Kanji University. Okay. We heard, we got many things about your presentation, and your this webinar is very, very fine and understandable. And I have one question, sir.
Yes.
Can I ask it, sir?
Yeah, sure, sure.
Sir, what is the minimum and maximum gain of the simple microstrip patch antenna design?
Okay, so considering the patch antenna, what we have to do is if you get for other students also I will just explain. So if you have 0 dB gain, which means it is isotropic, so it is radiating in all direction, and if you have some 2.17 or 2.71, it is dipole antenna. Okay, so for a proper patch antenna, the gain should be at least 5 dB. Okay, so if you get a 5 dB, then it is acceptable, and if you get a 8 dB, then it is excellent. Okay, so you try to maintain at least 5 dB, and if it exceed, if it touches 8 dB, then it is very good. Okay, so in my previous company, what I will do is I use a cavity backed patch antenna, which means the entire substrate will be covered with a metallic conductor. So in that case, the gain will add up more. So I will get around 8 dB. So 8 dB means it is perfect. If 5 dB means at least 5 dB, you have to try to get it.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much, sir. I have another question.
Yes, please.
Sir, I am designing an antenna, and how to make it is used for sensing of some other application, whether it is possible?
Sensing of other application means?
Medical application or...
Yeah, okay. So what kind of radiation you are planning to receive? Like it is from...
Sir, I didn't get.
Yeah, like antenna is mainly used for receiving some electromagnetic signals. So yes. What is the source for that electromagnetic signals? You mean a medical application means from human body or
sir, human body.
Okay, so in that case, actually you can get it, but we have to clearly understand what is the frequency which is emitting from. If, for example, there are some probes which is using for dictating signals from brain. So in that case, what we will do is from brain, there will be a minute signal, but it will be very low frequency, and it will be very low amplitude signals will be there. So if you want to capture that, what we have to do is, instead of antenna, we have to use probes. So that what probes will do is, it is like a coil like structure. So it is very near field, right? So I explained previously, for antenna to receive properly, we need at least some far field distance. So in that case, what we have to do is near field probes we have to use. So probes, what will do, it is not like an antenna, it is like something like a coil or another form of electric field dictators. By that only we can use it.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Sir, another question I have. For cognitive radio application and all, we are going to analyze a spectrum.
Okay.
For example, my antenna is working at particular frequency. For example, 5.5 gigahertz frequency means. Can I use that for identifying the spectrum in cognitive radio?
Identifying the spectrum means what
for user that? Transmission for user transmission.
Okay. Like
wireless communication, Wi-Fi. We are finding Wi-Fi frequency, Bluetooth frequency, and all. No. So, like that cognitive radio spectrum, can I use it for spectrum analysis of our frequency, resonant frequency?
That I'm not pretty much sure about. Maybe I will check and come back to you.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Yes.
Okay, sir.
Thank you so much. So any other query is there?
If there are any questions, you can unmute yourself or put in the chat box.
Okay. Yeah, okay. Somebody asked whether it is sender to sender. Yeah, yes, sender to sender, which we call it as pitch to pitch. I think this is for array you asked, right? Yes, it is sender to sender. Okay, so anything else is there? Yeah, slightly I can hear you.
I hope there are no more queries.
Just one second. KK sir was telling something.
Okay.
KK sir, can you come again that last sentence? Yeah, yes, sir, please, sir. Okay.
Can you hear me, Abhilash?
Yes, perfect.
Okay, all right. So I just wanted to say it was a very good presentation.
Thank you, sir.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
It was a very good presentation. And you know, you covered a lot of very fundamental things. So thank you for doing this. It was quite impressive as well. Like, I'm glad that, you know, you were able to, you know, work with so many antennas and, you know, in an automotive setup. That opportunity is very good. Now, regarding that one question that, you know, regarding sensor cognitive applications that the previous attendee was asking, I think you can use an antenna for both for transmitting and receiving. So when you're using it for cognitive radio, you're using the same antenna for sensing application. Instead of a transmit mode, you'll be using it in a receive mode. That's all. Okay.
Thank you so much, sir.
Okay, so the design process will remain exactly the same. It's just that you know, using that antenna in a receive mode. That's all.
Okay, sir.
Abhilash, but thank you very much for doing this. It was a good presentation.
Thank you, sir.
Actually, you know, even as faculty members, I think, you know, there were some very fundamental things that you know, the animations that you had, they're quite useful. You know, the animations and the figures that you shown was quite useful, even, you know, from a teacher's point of view as well, when you're teaching these courses and over here in the college as well. So thank you very much, Abhilash.
Thank you, sir. Okay, so any other queries from student side?
Sir, actually, I have one query. Actually, okay. Any other method for enhancing the gain other than that using array type? Any other method of increasing gain using this patch?
Okay, so you want patch antenna itself, but you have to increase
the gain. So
in that case, what we have to do now? So we have a lot of method. So I will figure out a few methods. Okay. So what we have to do is, so initially this is my patch antenna. For example, sorry for my bad drawing. So this is my patch antenna. Okay. So what I will do now? End of the day, what we have to do is, we have to increase the amount of the radiation coming out from it. Okay, so either you can use some slots like this. Okay, some slots will be helping you. Otherwise, what we have to do is, so under this is your substrate. Okay, so under the substrate, what we have, so you will have a ground. Okay, so from that ground, what you have to do is you have to increase the wall like this. Okay. So it should be covered with a metal. So as I previously explained, it is called cavity backed antenna. So it is not available much in IEEE paper or some other Google. So if we closed the entire surface with a metal, so the amount of electric field, instead of going to ground, the electric field will be more, it is coming to these walls. Okay, so more fringing field will add up together and it will create more electric field. As a result, your gain will be more. So if the antenna previously, if it is was like this, some 100 degree, after using this, it will be some 85 degree, like that, some minor changes, you can see it. Okay, and remaining all, it's up to you, like providing slot, changing the structure like square to circle, like that, all these things is based on your iterations. All these new iteration will give you another patterns. Okay, so am I covered your queries?
Thank you, sir. We are clear.
Yes, okay. So any other queries? Okay.
I think there are no more queries.
Yes,
so now I am. Is there any more query, anyone? So it's my privilege to propose a vote of thanks. First and foremost, I would like to thank Sir Sandosh. Sir has raised his hand. So before my vote of thanks, if you have any queries.
No, Sanjay, you can continue.
Okay, sir, thanks. So first and foremost, I would like to thank Dr. Krishnakumar Kishore, our Vice Principal and IEEE Branch Counselor, for his grateful presence and continual support. Thank you, sir. And I would like to thank Dr. V. Balamurugan, sir, our HP of Electronics and Communication Engineering Department, for guiding us from day one to till this point. And next, I would like to thank Mr. Abhilash Balachandran, our resource person. Thank you. It was very informative and exceptional presentation today. It was very, very informative, really. Thank you so much, sir. And I would also like to thank Mr. Professor Santosh C for supporting us to coordinate this event. And I would also like to thank everyone present here for the active support. Thank you, everyone, and have a good day.
Thank you so much.
Feedback link is posted in the chat section. Please fill it up for certificates.
Okay, thank you all. Kindly share the recorded link. I will go through it. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you all.